So, quiz question, I guess. What is the narrative of that song? Well, it does give you the subtitles. So.
Okay, no, I mean François Hardy, Ménage.
François Hardy. She's a little older than me. I don't know if you're familiar with her. I was a young person. She was much more famous than she is now in the United States. I think one of her main hits was My Friend the Rose. You guys remember that one?
I saw her recognize her voice from something,
but I didn't. Notice she's a little bit younger there. Oh, that's a rose. What's the narrative of Le Large, which is, I think, the departure, which I, watching it last night, interpreted as the elderly. I'm gathering it's the grandmother giving the grandson reassurance that things will be fine, even though she's taking that next departure. Does that make sense?
Could you just give us the narrative then?
I think so.
Now we've got to turn it into a page.
But the thing is, it's your interpretation, right? So, yeah, how do you interpret, you know?
I didn't even see the subtitles. I was kind of like, oh, this feels, yeah.
It looks pretty, I think the video itself seems pretty explosive. When I sail away, the song I was thinking of that seemed somewhat similar is the one from the last Lord of the Rings movie, the first series.
I was just about to say The Hobbit, sailing away at the
not
end.
Not
The Hobbit, yeah. But, you know.
Journey King.
Anyways, when they sail away with the elves at the end.
Yeah. You could be critical, though, because they're sailing into the west. Kind of screwed up on the whole east-west thing, you know. It's kind of interesting.
They're sailing into the west because they're preparing the new world.
I'm just going to lay it out there and let you play with it however you want. There's plenty of folks that look at Tolkien and try to interpret what's going on and all of that.
I think even Tolkien himself was like this said at some point, stop that. Just let it be.
Sometimes a cigar is just a cigar.
But this is not a pipe. Okay, so that was a quiz question. What's the narrative of that song? You might say that the sly reason for that is to try to get you to listen to French songs, but...
Too late.
Oui, magnifique.
Yeah, très bien, très bien. Okay. What is it like to be a bat? Have you ever wondered about that?
No.
Not really.
I frequently wondered what it might be like to be Batman, but I suppose that's a little different.
That's a good first step.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the conclusion Thomas Nagel gives us is what? We can't possibly know. But I think we can know precisely what it's like to be a bat.
That's why some women wear eyeliner and mascara. It's made from bat feces.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. All of it?
Yeah,
that's horrible.
Yeah.
Guano.
Yep.
Yeah.
Which is the word that I know of.
There's got to be more than one recipe.
I know that guano is worth a lot of money. The bat caves, they typically mine out the guano. I have been to several of the ones, like in Texas, where there's even a Hitchcock movie where the bats all come flying out of that one. I forget what the name of that one was.
Whose idea was that? Hey, hon, let's spread some animal crap on your face. That'll make you more attractive.
Most women don't know that.
Or a concentrated pregnant mare urine,
mm-hmm.
ingest it, and it looks like you're pregnant. They even called it pre-marin, pregnant mare urine, which is one of the brand names of the pill, right? Which is kind of cool.
Awesome.
That's just, I don't know why I'm throwing these weird things out there.
Well, I used to be hungry. Thanks.
That hurt. I'm not sure where that went. But, okay. So what's it like to be a bat? Why is he asking this question?
It's a pretty steep perception difference. I mean, pretty steep. Not massive, but steep.
But we do think about being bats and stuff.
Wondering about, you know, the conscious experience.
I know, all I can think of right now is no, 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 no.
Thank you.
Two separate writing styles, or written languages, depending upon which side of the mountains you're on? Because of historical geographical isolation?
Well, so, we can imagine what bats are like. Isn't that what it's like to be a bat?
I imagine so.
The way we imagine it, right? But also not. For one thing, bats probably don't even think about things. They don't use language, do they? Well, they do, don't they? They're mammals. Don't they have a language?
From my understanding, they've got a fairly sophisticated communication system.
Probably have names. Dolphins have names. Pets. They're cute little.
If they do have names, they translate some kind of smell, I would imagine, in the case of bats, but I'm not sure. I know they mark territory and stuff like that, but like really, like pheromones and theater, really.
Well, what he goes on to say is, I can't even know what it's like to be you.
Hmm.
So he starts off talking about bats, but when he gets right down to it, he says, I don't know what you are really thinking or what it's like to be you.
Everything's inherently subjective.
Right. And that becomes, at the end of the article, the big difference is the difference between subjective versus objective. We can't bridge that to know the objective.
Right.
Well, that seems to me a Kantian dilemma. Not a Hegelian dilemma. But let me also talk about the ethical aspects of this. So if you watch the video where he's lectured at Harvard, he's also talking about draw my map. Supposed to be a rectangle. You can make a square. You can have whatever kind of map you would like. I put the I, the self, over here. The we, over here. Certainty. Up here. Uncertainty. Spell it right. Looks close, right?
It's close enough.
Okay. So, over here, when we think ethically, Aristotle is an example of this, and he's eudaimonia. Susan Wolfe mentions eudaimonia as the only example she can think of. An ethical theory that focuses on the self. Is that right? Remember that page? So the self. Over here, a fairly typical individual. You pick lots, but I usually pick David Hume as the exemplar of the communitarian. So this is the communitarian point of view. The self is the most important part of my narrative. So I want to achieve excellence for myself. Now that doesn't mean that I don't care about everyone else, but the focus for me is on my excellence. So what I'm caring about other people is, in order to help them help me achieve excellence for myself. And that might mean that I want a good society, and I want good families, and I want people to be interested in education and all those kinds of things. But that's eventually so that I live in a place where I like to be. So the focus really on my ethical narrative, my meta-narrative, is my excellence. Right? Whereas David Hume focuses really more on the community. And the idea is that whatever I define as me is really based on what the community has raised me to believe. So I'm going to be thinking in terms of what the community has taught me to value most. A lot of folks think of him as kind of the feminist philosopher in ethics because he argues that reason is a slave to the passions. And in our tradition, we usually think of reason as associated with male dominance, whereas passions we usually associate with femininity. Not saying that that's necessarily where it ought to be, but traditionally that's kind of the split that we hear. And so since Hume it's for the passions. You grow up with these passionate feelings for these values, and then you learn how to reason, and then you use your reasoning skills in order to argue for what you're passionate about, right? So reason is the slave of the passions. Then we have certainty as the intuitive right things to do. The right thing to do, what is it? I know what it is. I intuit it. And that point of view is referred to as deontology. Deon is duty. So it's the study of duty. So my job is to do my duty. And a philosopher that we could put over here would be Kant. It's a perfect example of that. But religion, in the Christian sense, would also go there. God tells you to do something, and that's your duty, and regardless of whether you agree with it or not, that's what you have to do. So a deontological point of view would be normally associated with Christianity. Islam clearly would fit there, etc. Uncertainty, yes?
I'm going to ask, is that sort of a sort of more dogma than following certainty?
Yes. It includes dogma. Kant wouldn't necessarily be concerned so much about dogma, but he gives us what he calls his categorical imperative. And basically we'll argue that our knowledge is categorical. It's concepts. We break things up into concepts, and so all of our knowledge is essentially categorical, and we normally would think, well, ethics, we really don't know right or right from wrong. He says, hogwash, aber auf Deutsch, Scheinfleisch, or something, you know, whatever. You know, but in any case, you know, so yes, we know. You know, if I put you in an ethical dilemma, you immediately know the right answer. I'll give you one, right? So you're driving home, you're tired, it's already dark, late in the evening, the road is absolutely packed with vehicles, you're on a concrete highway, and something's happened up ahead, and so all the traffic is totally stuck. No one's moving. You notice in the car next to you, there's a beautiful woman. And in the car behind her, there's three ugly guys. Those three ugly guys, for some reason, are totally pissed off at the beautiful woman in the car in front of them. And since you're totally stuck and no one can move, the ugly guys get out of their car and they come over and they start pounding on her car, trying to get at her. You're sitting in the car next to her. Do you have a moral obligation to help the woman?
No.
Well, that's, you're supposed to email me that.
Is that a quiz question then?
That's the quiz question. But there's a follow-up question.
Oh, no, you can't. That's.
So the first part of the quiz question is, you haven't emailed me yet, so... The first part of the question is, do you have a moral obligation to help the woman? And the second question is, what do you imagine you might actually do in a situation like that? Of course, this is a real example. No one got out and helped her. She finally made a break for it, ran, and there was a bridge right there. And they chased her, and they were beating her up, and she jumped over the ledge of the bridge and drowned in the river. And of course, there were hundreds of people around watching all of this happen. What happened? It was in Detroit.
I explained it.
This happened?
That did happen.
And nobody helped her?
Nobody helped her.
Because people think they don't have a moral obligation.
What was the second part of the question? was the second part.
What do you think you would have actually done?
I think studies also show like the more people that are around, the less likely you are to help somebody.
That's true.
When you're driving like a busy highway and you see a hitchhiker, you're not really inclined to stop and help, but if you're like in the middle of nowhere and see a hitchhiker, people are more inclined to help.
They have done numerous studies that have shown also that when there's crowds of a group of people, that no one does anything because everyone thinks that someone else is going to do something. Yeah, say potato, potato.
I think Kant would tell us that everyone should feel they have a moral obligation to help the world.
But then when you try to help people, they sue you.
Well,
so
see, now that's where you're applying your environmental situation, your training. So that's not your immediate moral imperative, your categorical imperative, is it?
Well, my moral obligation to myself and my family exceeds my moral obligation to a stranger that I have.
Which would explain why, in
so
the real situation, you wouldn't have actually gotten out. But what do you feel?
What's your knee-jerk reaction? What's the basic knee-jerk you have? Nothing's been considered yet.
Mm-hmm.
And Kant
will argue that our biggest problem is that we know what the morally right thing to do is, but all those other factors enter in and we won't do what we know we ought to do.
Well, like I said, my moral obligation to myself and my family exceeds my moral obligation to a stranger.
Well, it depends. Are the guys like big and strong and scary? They look like
they're
going
to be.
Oh, they're huge. They're ugly.
She's screwed.
I know. My thought was I would step out of my car and immediately pee my pants. That's probably when I would realize, oh, I'm in trouble.
She should have invested in a taser and some pepper spray.
Of course, knowing me, I would probably say, hey guys, what are we trying to do here? Kill her? Why? You know, I don't know. I've had women in class say they would pull out a shotgun and blow them away.
When they get a shotgun in there, is that a suit?
Yeah, that
I don't know if you're allowed to have a shotgun in Detroit, but this is Alaska. But of course,
here,
I know some of you have your shotguns with you.
It's duck season.
Also,
right
you can't
now.
Just go shooting people.
There
has to be.
The requirement on the door says don't bring that pistol.
There has to be. In order for you to legally use lethal force, at least in most states, different than, it's not Texas we're talking about here, there has to be a specific genuine threat to life or limb. It doesn't have to be that they're going to kill you. It could be that they're going to maim you or hospitalize you or break your leg, life,
so,
limb, eyesight.
So
there's
an example.
Where they're beating the crap out of
her.
Yeah.
And also,
exactly.
By the way, I will point out that under the law in Alaska, you are allowed to use enough force to ensure your ability to make a safe retreat. That is specific legal language.
Now, I don't know if this defends Heinz's earlier position or not, but this point of view, which is actually the one he's taken, is utilitarianism. Notice the uncertainty. We don't have a certain moral interpretation of what we ought to do, as opposed to Kant, that says we do, right? And in fact, Thomas Nagel argues that if you do have such a moral imperative, an intuition that this is the right thing, we can ask where that came from, and we'll probably discover that it comes from environmental factors. So, if I were in Saudi Arabia and I see three ugly guys beating up a woman for driving in traffic, they're probably the police and they're doing what they're obligated to do.
Because they shouldn't be driving in the first place. Or did they just legalize that?
They just, I'm not sure where that has gone.
That's pretty horrible.
It just happened though.
That is absolutely shockingly horrible.
A Unless you're Saudi Arabian and you're absolutely horrified that women are going to be allowed to drive.
Well, I can't support something that is so abusive to a segment of the population.
Well,
that actually
but you're not Saudi Arabian, you weren't raised that way, and so the argument, though, is that if you were raised one way, you're going to have a moral imperative that's different than if you were raised another way.
Well,
and it's not that there's a universal human moral imperative that in any situation like this, this is the way we would behave because we're human.
Well, if you
clearly has to be a cultural point of view.
Actually, you don't even have to go into fiction. That's pretty extreme moral.
Examples.
Yeah, more strange, yeah, sort of strange moral geography, so to speak. And like, you know, if you go back to the Third Reich, like, there's a moral obligation to turn in anybody of Judaic faith.
Well, that's another great example of this, although both Susan Wolfe and Thomas Nagel critique the idea of coming up with manufactured examples. Sorry about the. It's an embedded habit. And that's you know, someone comes to the door, says, "Do you have any Jews in the house?" And you do. You have Helen Keller. No, not Helen Keller.
Anne
Frank, thank you.
They would have done it to her, too.
Sorry about that.
No, they
wires crossed, right?
Helen Keller was very proud of the fact that her books were among the first.
Anne Frank, you know, is upstairs in the room, and the Nazis are at the door. And they say, "Do you have any Jews in here?" And, you know, if they go up there, they will find her. And you're under obligation. Boy, you're in bad shape, but you already have her. Well, so that's pretty bad.
Well, that's simple. So, you say, "I don't know, you're so sneaky, why don't you go look?"
Do you lie?
And then if she's well hidden enough, and they go look, and they don't find her, but you said, "I don't know, they're so sneaky, why don't
but
you go look?"
You
off the
believe
hook.
In
you
the commandment, which one was it? That says, "Thou shalt not bear false witness." You're not supposed to lie under any circumstances. And yet, under this kind of a situation, what do you do?
And not just that, you're also dealing with Nazi Germany. You don't exactly, the Gestapo doesn't exactly.
Certainly,
process.
But I will point out that actually in the Old Testament, there is actually an example of God commanding people to lie. When I want to say, is it
remember
Abraham?
God evolved.
Say again.
God evolved. So as you look at the Old Testament, there's earlier.
Uh-huh. But
there are folks
the
that wrestle with God, but there's
flying.
A gradual, what's called the hidden face of God. Eventually,
okay.
God becomes invisible. Has a sacred seat that
much an exception to
is invisible.
Like, don't lie unless, you know, this, or don't lie unless that.
So,
you know.
So it's problematic referring to scripture of 350 BC, 500 BC,
I make up my
700 BC, comparing it to Paul Tillich. President Trump. How'd that get in there? Sorry.
By the way, everyone should look up the legal doctrine of disparity of force in regards to the quiz question.
Kant, example of deontology. Who's an example of utilitarianism? We've got some excellent examples. Thomas Nagel, for one. Susan Wolfe, for two. John Stuart Mill.
And Heinz.
And pragmatist in general, probably. It's British point of view, utilitarianism. And, of course, just a British colony, most of us are utilitarians. That could have been fun. No one stood up for that. But so, now that I've got this basic outline for my map, sorry, Kant's actually in the map, but that's it. It's because I'm not tall enough to go all the way up there. But so, this is birth. All of you were born, right? Had a mother? Yes. Had a father too? Apparently not everyone does. You know, but you know, Annie Skywalker. Sure, couldn't explain it, right? Annie Skywalker. Darth Vader.
Yeah.
Was an immaculate? No. Well, she wasn't immaculate. Well, never mind. Forget it. I shouldn't say that.
I think only Padme calls
the Immaculate Conception is actually that Mary was born without sin. Not that she conceived Jesus without having a husband, yeah, etc. Sorry, that was levity. That was levity, and I don't know what relation that is to Leviticus. So, let's so birth. We were born, and when we're born, we don't have any of this stuff because we haven't quite gotten off of the drugs, apparently. You know, we're kind of in an LSD state, apparently. Just heard. Did you hear that?
Is that recent science?
Yeah, it came out the other day.
It's been popular for a while now. That's sort of the state babies are in sort of this constant LSD-esque state, which makes sense if you think about it.
However, so we're born, and we typically head this way. And that's assuming you're in a family that loves you, that raises you with all our typical beliefs, that they know what the principles are of their meta-narrative, and they inculcate them in you, so that you grow up to feel certain about the same things. That's why children usually believe what their parents believe, at least initially. And we're moving in this direction, right? Which moves us towards what I think is the happiest state for a human being. And that's a situation where you're absolutely certain about everything and you're concerned about the community. So that's kind of the happiest situation.
Fine. But if you're absolutely certain about everything, doesn't that imply stunted growth then? Because if I'm absolutely 100% positive about everything and there's nothing more to learn, then, you know, am I no longer developing or growing, you know, spiritually, intellectually, etc.?
This is very...
Who else would you put up in this corner?
I want to put a term up there, kind of say bliss, almost, but it's not quite what I want.
Ah, but yeah. Ignorance is bliss.
They would argue on au contraire, they like French, right? That ignorance of evil things is not something that you should. I mean, you know, if I go read Noam Chomsky, it's not because I want to destroy my conservative point of view. It's because I feel like I ought to know what Noam Chomsky is saying.
Well, anyway, what you said, anybody says in here is bliss. I feel like they have never, you know, read a history book because I don't think Pearl Harbor was very blissful for anybody ever seeing. So,
but so I mean, by the way, this is my map. You can make your own map.
I don't know. It was the happy place for the Japanese.
Yeah, but they knew.
Culturally, if you don't have any doubts about what's right or wrong, that's very satisfying.
And horrible and dangerous.
Only if you're in a society that values
knowledge,
diversity.
Well, I don't know.
Diverse societies might be very wonderful and give lots of people opportunity, but it's very scary living in a very diverse society. Because you don't know what you're going to do, you don't know what you're going to be, you don't know what values you ought to believe in. You go to philosophy class and you have your beliefs presented as those beliefs belong in this box, but these people believe these things and these people believe things. Why do you think your beliefs are better than theirs?
Maybe they're not better. Maybe they can
but
equally coexist.
This is true. They think this is true.
There can be
this
more
is
than
true.
One truth.
But that's
very hostile to people that don't want to hear it, because you're.
But that's the root of freedom, the very core essence
who
and root of freedom.
Who wants freedom?
To
you
disagree.
Want to be saved.
The ability to be different.
Is this fun or what?
Oh yeah! No, yeah.
Isn't it? Wouldn't you agree that the root of freedom is the ability to be different than someone else? Because if you're forced or required to be the same as everyone else, then you're not free.
An awful lot of the problems in this world started only when the concept of freedom was invented.
Ooh.
Go to China. There's over a billion people in China. If you started infecting them with the concept of freedom, do bats feel like they're free? Do Chinese people feel like they're free?
Not the ones who were murdered at Tiananmen Square.
They were rebels, though. They were infected by the concept of freedom, and look where it got them. If we're thinking about bats, and can we know what it's like to be a bat? Can we know what it's like to be you? Can we know what it's like to be someone who hasn't grown up speaking English?
You can all pretend to know.
I know people who can make a dang good guess, but yeah, I'm not sure if you can really know. So
here's just kind of a crazy metaphor. If we think of our heads as computers, and we're running programs, but those programs have to be loaded on an operating system. And the operating system is, say, English. And there are some programs that you can't load on a person's head unless they speak English or a modern European language, or a Western European language, maybe European in general. But it has to be affected by the Greeks, because you have to have basically Aristotle's logic. Is an ability, right? Did I mention that one philosopher from Beijing was here and said that Chinese people cannot think in Western metaphysics? They cannot think in Aristotelian logic because they don't have the verb to be, so they can't use our basic sentence structure. Did I talk about that? The AEIO statements?
No.
Mm-hmm.
So, but that doesn't make a lot of sense.
I know what you're referring to only because I've been to China and I almost ended up in prison there. And yeah, good times.
Okay, so this is thanks to Aristotle, but it's embedded in Western languages. There are four types of statements that we can make that are either true or false. One type is the A statement. So all S is P, or every S is P. That's the universal affirmative. Everything in the subject set is also in the predicate set. Or the things that I'm saying about the subject set, they are all predicate. Whatever, right? All horses are animals. No S is P, or none of the subject is predicate. That's an E-type statement, universal negative. You're saying all of the things in the subject set are excluded from all of the things in the predicate set. So no dogs or cats.
There's a cartoon called Cat.
An I statement is some S is P, so some of the members of the subject set are also in the predicate set. It's the particular affirmative. That horse is a gelding, for example. Some S is not P, that horse is not a gelding. So A-E-I-O. The medievals or others refer to as a, well, that's in the middle. It's argument based on that. There are relationships. This is referred to as the traditional square of opposition. So this is from roughly 350 BC. If you're an educated person in the West, you would have been familiar with this. We used to have this as mandatory college education up until about 1950, when students started not liking it, and so colleges that wanted to appeal to students and keep their business started dropping courses that the tradition said they ought to have. So if you're wondering why we have less logic in the United States now, no one gets the course. It's not mandatory. Good idea, actually. Okay. But so, these are the kinds of statements that can be true or false. So, if, remember I said this is a cup. That's an example of an A statement. Everything that is this cup, or everything that is this, rather, is, in the set of things, it's a cup. Well, so if you don't have the grammatical ability to do this, which is also referred to as the it's not the equal sign, but it works kind of like an equal sign. There's another name for it.
Boolean logic? Turn on
Boolean logic? Yes, as in yes or no.
Mike, it's not important, right? I'm getting old enough that my mind doesn't remember everything I think. There are some arguments against this, but the main thing about that is that in English, it seems like if you have the A statement true, it shouldn't imply that the I statement is true. So if we say all unicorns have a single horn, that's true, but if I say that unicorn has a single horn, it seems like that unicorn actually has to exist for that statement to be true, and so there's existential import in that statement, which is not in the A statement, which is a definition of a unicorn. And so it seems like in modern English, the whole square doesn't work the way it traditionally did, so that's why they removed some of the elements that were in the traditional square. So if I'm speaking to someone whose language is incapable of running this software, I cannot upload programs that are mandatory for our society into their head. They're like a Mac, and I can't upload, you know, a PC program into their head. Unless they learn one of those languages that has that, and it's successful enough, it takes, that now we can upload those programs. You know, so you need to install a Western European language in their head. Does that seem fair? Does that seem right? One of the first things you do is you teach them the language. You go to Germany, immigrants coming in, the first thing they have to do is spend 2 years learning German. Right? It's one of the things that they're doing there. Yes? So, and by the way, some of the other programs that you need this ability to run is the idea to think of yourself as a self, because it's actually a program that your society, your peers, your parents upload in your head so that they start asking you questions. What do you think about such and such? How do you feel? Do you want pie? etc., right? That arguably is a Western characteristic that's relatively recent. They argue over when it started. Harold Bloom, for example. Oops, I'm actually in the text, sorry. Argues that this software program that created the modern self, the self-reflecting individual, which they also talk about. Before that, you had the pre-reflective cogito, which is cogito, I think, before you have reflection, you have the pre-reflective cogito. But when was this actually invented? Harold Bloom, Shakespeare critic, teacher, argues that it was Shakespeare invented the human, the modern human, and very specific place where he invented it. Wait, that's Harold Bloom. Sorry. This can't be the whole book. I don't know what it is. Notice Harold Bloom has written a few things.
I don't know, 770 pages long.
In any case, he says the spot where Shakespeare invented reflection is in Hamlet. And I bet you know the spot.
To be or not to be.
To be or not to be. Because Hamlet is standing on the stage and thinking to himself. Prior to this, says Harold Bloom, now I don't have the experience that he does with literature, but it seems to me it ought to have been somewhere in the past that other people thought to themselves. Well, find it. Where is it? Augustine, interestingly enough, talks to God all the time. So he's never talking to himself when he's, you know, what were you doing before you made everything? He says. He's talking to God, right? He's not talking to himself. So is he self-reflecting? Of course, you might argue that, of course, he is using self-reflection.
How is this concept that you're discussing now interrelated with what you talked about last class about the bicameralism of the mind?
Well, that would have been even earlier, and still problematic, because if you're psychotic and you feel like you're hearing voices, where are those voices coming from? Are they coming from your quantum mind interconnecting with other persons that we just can't see, or still quantum, I would imagine, right? But nonetheless, it would be something in the cloud of your current experience. But if you don't have the program that says to you, the voices I hear are me thinking to myself. Remember, even they think that when people used to read, they read out loud. It's like a specific time in history when people started reading quietly to themselves. In the late Middle Ages, otherwise they actually read out loud. The symbols didn't actually mean anything unless it was expressed out loud.
So you weren't. Well, people still do that too.
Yeah. But so
that'd be interesting.
This interesting problem here is that what we've got is the evolution of the self.
Oh.
Yes.
I was going to say, I mean, as a sort of an extension of the whole sort of coded language. My mother worked with blind and visually impaired and the deaf and all that, and you just a small, you know, hop and skip over. It's not even part of a different culture, but a slightly different language base. like people who use sign language. It is a different language. It really is. Though, you know, having to read, learning to read, learning to read Braille is very much its own code. So there's an odd language break there. So even though they're speaking a Western language, essentially, there's basically no S change, as you're saying. They're still an operating system.
Very hard to tell jokes for me to someone who can't hear.
All right.
And their jokes are not... They don't make sense to me. Although I've heard some and I've laughed because I know I was supposed to.
You big phony.
I'm pretending to teach. I'm not really a
That reminds me of the expression from the Soviet Union. They pretend to pay us, so we pretend to work.
Have you seen, I think it's called The Arrival?
The movie.
Yeah, and they teach her that language, and then it opens up all these...
possibilities.
Kind of, yeah, so it's the same kind of...
Yeah.
That's what it makes me think
of. None of this is actually my own idea. I'm just not quoting everybody that I'm thinking about, because I'm...
Oh, yeah.
But here's another one. This one is Charles Taylor, Sources of the Self. And, oh, incredible. The detail, he goes from incremental steps of the development of the modern self. Literature, how the literature influences this guy influences this, this one, this. And you gradually get, and by the way, it's not one single modern coherent identity that we all share. No, we've got all sorts of elements, all kind of entangled, you know, different, you know, types of justice, you know, enlightenment. What kind of enlightenment do you have? You know, lots of different kinds of enlightenment. What kind of self might you have? You think of books, arguments about how many different cultures there are in the United States because of all the different individual, you know, groups that came over at the different times that they came over and what cultural influences they brought with them, how that affects voting, politics, you name it, right? That's all part of that. So, some theses that associate with this, that the closer our linguistic abilities, our language, our vocabulary are to one another, the more I understand you. The farther apart, of course, well, what are we talking about? If I'm understanding you, I'm understanding your language and the way you express your feelings in that language. Does that all make sense? By the way, part of our educational process, the more you learn about other people, by reading novels about other people, the more you study other foreign languages and you learn about those people, the broader your own ability to appreciate other people grows, and so you understand people that you wouldn't have understood before. You know, they're in that box, they believe this, they believe this, they believe this. You can understand all of those, and of course, then you of course end up in the dilemma, well, which is the right set of beliefs, so on. Could be very difficult for you, actually, when you're aware of all of these groups. Remember David Foster Wallace, big scary situation there. Now, I don't have the language that the bat has. So when the bat says, well, I don't know. Is he hungry? Probably. He just woke up. I bet he's hungry. No, maybe he has to pee. How do you let a bat out? They don't go out to pee, they just pee right there. That would seem to be a problem if you're upside down. can ask the bat, how do you do that? I don't know. How do they do it?
Answer, they don't really smell bad all the time.
Maybe they only pee or poop while they're in flight.
Yeah, no.
We're standing here in a room with...
I don't know.
How did they find that out? They asked the bat, and the bat explained, hey, this is how I do it, right? So, but on the other hand, I can certainly say I don't understand what a bat is thinking, because I'm so completely different. But it seems like a dumb question to ask that. I've killed plenty of bats in my day. What's my day? That's really weird. But I used to work at Friends Boarding Home in Concord Meeting. Westchester, and my job was being a night watchman, where I went around at night and checked the security of the building, etc., the fire watch, etc. It was full of retired people that were all sleeping and so on. But they had these hallways, right? And during the summers, they would open their windows and the bats would get in to the building. And at the same time, if they got into one of their rooms, they were scared to death of bats. You imagine, especially 90-some-year-old woman, she's under the sheet, and you have to go in, find the bat in her bedroom, get rid of it. Right? Well, what we did was we carried a tennis racket, and we'd be walking around with the clock that we had to punch and the tennis racket, which can result in some funny stories, but as we'd be walking along, you'd see the bat coming. Down the hall. And you just wait. And as it gets there, you go, funk. Just like badminton. And the bat would like fold its wings up and go, dead.
That's just mean.
Well, you're supposed to get rid of them.
Bats are good for the environment. Bats are insectivores and they eat a lot of insects that otherwise
carry. As a college student, this was fun. Rid of the bats. But where did the bats show up here? Is this a fun map? You'd like to do? You can make your own map. But so our problem is we're born, we come along this way, and then typically what happens is our school system pulls us down this way. It starts hitting us with science. Science believes that to say that you know for sure something is the dumbest thing you can say. And they know that for sure. A hypothesis. You have a hypothesis, you should support them, right? So as a kid, you're in school and you're supposed to do your science project and you have the problem, why does ice melt? My hypothesis, heat makes the ice melt. I will test this by taking ice cubes from the ice cube bag and putting them on a burner and see if the ice melts. And you do it and you get, yes. Heat makes the ice melt, right? So you're learning the scientific method in third grade or whatever. My favorite was a math thing. And the kid was sitting there and he had iron filings all over him. He was just loaded with iron filings and his magnets. He's got all these different magnets and he's got the sloppiest looking poster you ever did see, handwritten, like 20 different experiments, with drawings and stuff that he clearly did himself. And he's literally sitting there doing all these experiments on the table. And all the other graders walked right by him and went, ugh, don't didn't give him a ribbon. And I walked by and I looked at it, and you know, the girl right next to him had a beautiful poster that was clearly printed right off of Wikipedia. And she had ribbon. This is the only scientist we have in this whole show. Give him a ribbon.
Did anyone actually do it?
He was actually the... As a result, we tend to start falling away from the certainties that we have as kids. You probably remember when that happened. That was traumatic for you, right? Especially if you also thought that your parents were dumb or lying to you. So, for example, how many of you had the tooth fairy give you a quarter? Or any money when you lost a tooth?
I'm sorry.
Anybody remember? No? What's the tooth fairy? You didn't have that experience. Sorry. It's fun. You lost a tooth when you were a kid, right? What did your parents do with it?
They usually throw, they was done in front of me.
They threw it?
They believe in that by throwing the tooth on your back, you may be able to grow like
a new one.
Oh. Yeah.
but I mean, you know, when your child first loses a tooth, you know, and it's bleeding and crying, because it knows all this blood gushing out of its mouth is not supposed to happen. You know, and so they come to you, she comes to you, and you look at your child and you smile and you tell the child, oh, you've lost your first tooth. We can put this under your pillow and the tooth fairy will give you money for your tooth. And the child instantly stops crying. No longer worried about the blood gushing. It's still gushing blood. And it's hard. Money? I'm going to get money for this.
How much?
They put money under the pillow. You know, some people that come to this country have trouble with the tooth fairy.
They're only upset because all the baby teeth are gone by then.
How do you spell basil? Basil. Basil.
You might have better luck going to YouTube to search for a video as opposed to Google. Get better results that way myself.
Yeah, YouTube's way better than Google.
If you're looking specifically for a video, yeah. I mean, you'd think it'd be the same, but...
What?
Unless you're looking for Alex Jones.
Maybe... Thank you.
But it's cool to be Greek, not so much because of all the success of the movie, The Big Fat Greek Wedding, not because of the success of the Olympic Games in 2004 in Athens, not because of every Greek festival you people have been to. It's always been cool to be Greek, and I'll tell you why. Because of our faith. We are Greek Orthodox. And our religion is different than anyone else's in this room. I swear, because everything that we celebrate late. We celebrate everything. We celebrate Easter a week after regular Easter. We're the only people who can make Jesus come back twice in the same freaking year. So about a week after, 2 weeks, sometimes even 5 weeks after, which is great because our candy is so much cheaper. Of course, you always get the broken chocolate bunnies that you bastards never buy. It took me 20 years to realize that chocolate bunnies do have ears. Never got a fresh peep. Little marshmallow peeps. By the time I got them, I can break windows with a damn thing. My mother screwed up every piece of Americana things that you people took for granted because you were born here. My mom screwed up. She didn't know. Screwed up things like the tooth fairy. How can you possibly screw up the tooth fairy? I go, Mama, my tooth fell out. What do I do? Don't worry about it. I'm going to take care of everything. She takes my tooth, puts it into my pillow. The next morning, I look. I eat my pillow. I find my mother's and father's personal check for $10. I'm not an idiot. I know what's going on. I took that check down, so I said, Mom, Dad, the Tooth Fairy is embezzling money from you, Dad.
So foreigners can have a hard time with the Tooth Fairy. But, I mean, you know, you put money in the pillow. The next time the poor child is, doing this and smacking her head against the wall, and you're like, what are you doing? She says, I'm trying to get this tooth out. And you're like, no, you have to wait. You can't hurry this up, you know, you have to wait. Eventually, though, the child comes to you and says, the tooth fairy forgot to give me money for my tooth last night. And she looks right at you. And you know that she knows that you're the tooth fairy. She's blaming you for... So she's learned there's not little winged creatures that actually come and take your teeth.
So your child's an extortionist now.
She's still playing the game. She's converted to understanding how the game works. Same thing with Santa Claus. How many of you believe in Santa Claus? Remember, if the post office believes it, that's a movie.
And I've been to the North Pole.
We've been to the North Pole. did I ask you a second quiz question yet?
Yep.
You did.
You actually gave us three, actually.
Shoot.
It was the moral dilemma.
The moral dilemma. Oh, yeah, because that's two of them. I would love to ask you, though, do you think it's lying to your children to tell them there's a tooth fairy?
Yes. Of course, anyway.
Or a Santa Claus?
Yes, but
so we get extra credit for this, or is this the two questions for next week?
Yes, I'll give you an A plus.
Wait a second, because you said that there's going to be two quiz questions per class, but some classes might not have.
Well, this one's just such a good question. What do you think? Is it lying? I've had folks say, yeah. I would never lie to my child. I would never tell them there's tooth fairies and stuff. That's robbing them of an incredibly wonderful childhood experience, don't you think?
Starting
Santa Claus?
Young with lies.
The realization
that it wasn't real. That's not very.
You were crushed.
Yeah, it was.
Well, that's course, that's what I'm zooming in on here, is what happens when your old childhood beliefs are suddenly crushed by...
It's a very sharp turn is what that is.
Yeah, that becomes a real problem, but I've got to shut up, don't I?
Yep. But I'm out of here.
Is this fun?
Is there, I'm sorry, did I miss, is there a minimum amount of words you want for the quiz questions?
Not on the quizzes.
Okay.
A paragraph is what he says on the syllabus.
Yeah. You can write as much as you like. Remember, my belief is that the more exercise you do, the stronger the muscles get, and that's a language thing.